next generation of fluorescent protein from Sabah's coral. Dr. KENNETH RODRIGUES has been involved in research pertaining to the biodiversity in Sabah since 2004 using molecular approaches. His research commenced with a project that catalogued the molecular diversity of Sabah's endangered sleeper orchids of Kinabalu National Park. He has been involved in the exploration of marine diversity of endangered reef fishes and corals with the goal of developing strategies for conservation based on molecular breeding approaches. His current research work is focused on cataloging the microbial diversity of Mamut copper mine acid mine drainage site in Ranau with the aim of understanding how bacteria adapt to acid mine drainage. Today's presentation will focus on the Nidarian coral diversity of Sabah with an emphasis on how the knowledge gleaned from this study can be applied to catalyze the biotechnology industry in Sabah. Please, you may proceed with your presentation.
Thank you, Madam Chairperson. Thank you very much for inviting me here. Very good morning. Selamat pagi, selamat sejahtera. Thank you for your invitation, Dr. Pata. It has been a privilege to work with you on this project. So when I began, I actually have to thank the Sabah Biodiversity Center for entrusting us with this project. It was, we just were a group of researchers, and Dr. Fatah came into our lab and he entrusted us with this big project. And we actually struggled to deliver. We had difficulties, we faced challenges, but at the end of the day, we delivered a genome, and we also discovered some very interesting things about corals. Now this lecture is intended as a public lecture, so I have put in a lot of photographs of corals. I cannot discuss the genome because that's all data, it's big data, but I can tell you the contextual approach when we use genome data. Okay, so what is a coral? In fact, if we look at corals and we ask most people, they won't know the answer. In fact, when I started off on this project, I didn't know what it actually looks like. And what's amazing about corals is that they are very small cells. Actually, they are free living organisms, they are planktonic, but they will settle down at one location and then they will build a whole reef. So this is a very important paradigm for development biology. We need to understand how a small organism can build up this array of reefs or coral reefs. Okay, so corals actually belong to anthozoans, and if you refer to scientific literature, they are called nidarians. And all these photographs are from Sabah. So you will see that in the corals, there are two types of corals. The first are the soft corals and the second are the hard corals. Now the soft corals, the ones you see in aquarium displays, you will see them moving around. You will see the bubble forms. I will show you some examples of soft corals. You will see them on aquarium tanks. And you also have the anemones, which are having fluorescence as well. And you have the hard corals. Hard corals are the acropora, and these hard corals are reef-building corals. You'll find them in the Great Barrier Reef. They are very important in terms of ecology because they sequester carbon. They sequester a large amount of carbon in their carbon sinks. So these corals are important in terms of ecology, but we looked at it in terms of the biotechnology of corals. So what we look for is fluorescent proteins, and I will give you an introduction to fluorescent proteins as I proceed, as I go along. So this is basically what happens in corals. They will set off, they will start off as planktonic forms, and they will settle at certain locations, and they will form symbiotic associations with dinoflagellates. And this is a very interesting relationship because the dinoflagellate supplies the coral with nutrients, and the coral provides protection to the dinoflagellate. Okay, so this is an example of how, if you can look at the top left-hand corner, that's how it starts off. And if you look at the bottom left-hand corner, you will see that the coral actually have tentacles. Yeah, some of the corals actually have nematocysts or stinging cells, and they will actually capture small prey, invertebrates, or even maybe small fish, and consume the proteins from those organisms. So corals and dinoflagellates have symbiosis. So you cannot, they cannot exist without each other. Okay, this is one of the most widely studied species, it's Symbiodinium. It's associated with coral. It produces bioactive compounds on its own, and it provides the sugars and the oxygen required for the sustenance of the coral. Okay, so this symbiodinum in itself is a study. You can have diversity, and if you can note in the study, which is a published paper, there's the highest diversity is in the coral triangle region, which is around Borneo. So there's a high diversity of this species, which indicates that they may have a very strong relationship with the diversity of corals. Okay, and they produce a compound which was used actually for bioimaging. It's called peridinium. Okay, this is produced by the dinoflagellates. Now the challenge with working with corals is it's very hard to differentiate between the peridinium, which is a fluorescent compound produced by the dinoflagellate, and the fluorescent compound produced by the coral. So these are some of the corals of Sabah, and this is the locations. We have deliberately not indicated the coordinates because we are afraid that prospectors may go in and pick up all these coral beds. So we just have markings, but we have obtained approvals from the Sabah parks before we conducted the study. Yeah. So this is one of our dive sites. You can see the Acropora beds. Now Acropora, because hard coral appears to be dead, but it's actually alive. Whereas the soft corals, when they undergo what is known as coral bleaching, they will actually have a loss of the coloration. Okay, so once we collected the samples, we basically go for sorting of the samples. We sort out the samples and then we classify them based on the taxonomy. We also use a procedure known as DNA barcoding to identify the coral species using a specific DNA marker. Okay, I'll go through some libraries which we developed. We have hundreds of corals which we isolated, but what we were looking for is fluorescent proteins for downstream application. This was our intention to the aim of the project. So this is Colastria species, which has a green fluorescence. This is another species of soft coral, which has a green fluorescence. Now, the reason why we do this fluorescence study is to identify whether the coral is producing any fluorescent proteins. Once we identify the fluorescent protein, we then look back at the DNA. So, at the end of the day, we won't be harvesting the coral unsustainably. Once we have the gene responsible for the fluorescent proteins, we will actually produce the fluorescent proteins in bacteria. So that's we won't touch the coral again. So now all we need for the study is a piece of coral about the size of your finger. That's sufficient for the DNA and protein studies. So we don't go and break off corals again. Okay, this is another species. As you can see, the fluorescence is green. Now these images have been taken using a special method. So what we do is we take the coral and we expose it to blue light. Okay? Blue light excites the fluorescence, and what we get back is a green light. So this phenomenon is present in coral. You can also see it in jellyfish, but you need the blue light to excite the wavelength. Okay, this is a Galaxia species. Now I have shown you examples of green corals. Okay? These are mostly green. As you can see, the intensity is different. Now this is a green color. If the lights are dim, you can actually see it's not totally green, it's actually a bluish green, it's cyan, okay, something different from green. So you get different grades of green in coral. So surprisingly, when you look at corals from the perspective of fluorescence proteins, you will see amazing diversity which you won't even see in the physical appearance of corals. Okay. Now this is a very interesting example. This is a coral which has green and red fluorescence. Now, why corals produce fluorescence is a matter of debate, but most likely they are produced in response to excessive UV radiation. So when you have too much UV radiation, the coral quenches, so it burns off some of this radiation in terms of the fluorescence proteins. Okay, so then you have the fluorescence as a byproduct. So they don't actually, this is the excessive energy which they're actually burning off from UV. This is the anchor coral, which has intense green and intense red. So we are also looking at different spectra, which are the infrared proteins. Okay, the infrared protein. Now these proteins have applications in your imaging system. So you can inject them into cells, and then you can flash lights like the blue light, and you can check for fluorescence based on the activity of the fluorescent protein in the cell. This is Cycloceris. This is one of the corals which we sequenced the genome. As you can see, it got two types of fluorescence, and it has its own intense fluorescence as well. So you can see three. The first picture is actually in normal light. The other two are under specific wavelengths. This is a button coral. It's very interesting because it got three or more than three colors. Okay, when you look at it in high resolution, it actually maps. You have many colors inside that. So this may be, you can see that green is there, and I actually have made a montage, so the green actually represents the gray area on top. So when you look under normal light, it's gray. But when you look under the specific spectrum, it's actually green and red. So these are maybe signs of aging. So as they age, maybe their proteins change. So you have the center part which is growing, which is green, and then it goes along the red periphery. Now this was a very interesting coral, Acropora. Actually, the person who was the researcher, Rolando, actually focused on Acropora, and he found an amazing diversity of Acropora. Now all the Acropora to an untrained viewer, when I first started up, appear to be the same, but actually they are different species. Okay? They are formed by different organisms, and each organism has basically incorporated a specific body plan. Okay? So he has, our student has prepared an entire database of these corals. And this work was published in Zootaxa. In fact, the editor of this journal had come to verify whether these corals are actually genuine or not. And it was published. And what we found is there was a first record of 12 new species of Acropora which had not been reported in Sabah. This is because these species are actually found in Indonesia, but because of the currents in the coral family, they disperse their spores. So when you find reports of new species of coral or new records of coral in different parts of Southeast Asia, it means that the currents are actually moving the spores around, because they can only be dispersed by a current. Okay, they don't swim. These zoospores don't swim around. Okay, now at the end of this study, the first part, we actually prepared a database of the more than 100 specimens with the fluorescent signals, the fluorescent signatures, and we presented this to the Sabah Biodiversity Center. Okay, now let's go into the depth of what we are looking for, which is the fluorescent proteins. The primary aim of this project was to look at fluorescent proteins and identify the genes which are responsible for the synthesis of these fluorescent proteins. So, to speak about, we cannot speak about fluorescent proteins without mentioning the late Professor Dr. Roger Sen. He has spent his entire lifetime working on fluorescent proteins. He discovered these fluorescent proteins actually in Aquaria victoria, which is actually a jellyfish. Now this jellyfish protein is very interesting. The jellyfish produces the blue light which is required in order for the green light to be excited. Corals do not produce blue light. They don't have the genes or the systems to produce blue light. So they only produce the fluorescence. Now in corals you can only see the fluorescence when you flash an excitation wavelength which is blue. Okay, so now these systems, or basically Aquaria victoria system, has been used to develop the fluorescent proteins. Now this is what it looks like. You can imagine a fluorescent protein like a bucket. You see a bucket, and the core, or the fluorescent part, is actually in the center of the bucket. Okay, imagine a bucket. So now the purpose of that bucket is to protect the central core. You can see the green one is the bucket. I'll zoom on the central core. And that is the chromophore. Now this is only few amino acids long, but this is the one which renders the protein fluorescent. So you can basically imagine, you take out the whole bucket, you unwrap, and the core is the fluorescent part. Now the purpose of that outer core, the green core, is to protect this central domain from water. Okay? These proteins will not fluoresce. Suppose I have to take out this yellow portion and put it in a glass of water, it will not fluoresce. It requires the green part to protect it from water. However, if I were to take this yellow core and put it in an organic solvent, it will fluoresce. Okay? So because our systems, our biological systems, are primarily based on water, we are water-based organisms, we need this protection from water. It's a hydrophobic core. Okay? So that's how the proteins actually function. Okay, so now you'll be amazed at the change in the color. The change in the fluorescence is not caused by the outer, what I described as the bucket, is the central few amino acids. So green has actually got tyrosine and glycine residues. So when an amino acid changes, you get a whole array of colors. Okay? Now, these fluorescent proteins are used for cell imaging. But one of the things which you have to take into account when we use fluorescent proteins is if whether they will elicit an immune response in our cells. Okay, so this is the thing which we work on. So you discover a protein, you synthesize or you produce a protein, but you need to assess whether this protein has a immunogenic response in your system. If it does, then it cannot be used as a marker because it will generate antibodies in your cells as well. Okay, so these are some of the proteins which are developed. So over the years, these proteins have been engineered. They have been engineered to produce different colors. And the reason why you use the colors because you can use them to palette. You can use them like a painter uses a paintbrush to paint across your cell and identify different sections of your cell. Okay, there are also the K-type proteins, and this is what we are interested in this project. We are looking at proteins which are photoconvertible. So if you have a photoconvertible protein, you can change the color with using UV light, and this can be used as an indicator. For instance, you want to check you want to use it in a cosmetic. You can have cosmetics which are containing these proteins, and you can look at yourself under blue light, and you can see whether you are exposed to UV across the day. So these are things which we are looking for in terms of intellectual property. One of the most common usage of these proteins is imaging or bioimaging, in which you can paint the cell with different kinds of colors of proteins using antibody label FPs. Okay, so at the end of this study with fluorescence, we actually prepared a library of proteins. So we have, as you can see, each coral has its assigned protein. So we have a color map for a protein. We also check these proteins to determine whether they were true proteins by using a protease assay. We extract the protein and we degrade it with an enzyme known as a protease. So if the enzyme degrades the protein, means you lose the color, you basically, it's not a protein, it's something else. So if you have a negative, basically after treatment with the protease, you basically have retention of color, it means it's something else. So we use a protease-based assay to determine whether these are true proteins or whether they are just chromophores from other organic compounds. So finally, we went down, we screened these corals, and we came down to around three of them, and three of them we sequenced the genome. Now, the genome of this particular coral is about 420 megabases, which is about the size of 100 bacterial genomes. And they contain approximately 23,000 genes. Now, once we sequence the genome, we obtain the sequences for the fluorescent proteins. However, what the state of Sabah gains is the database of genes. Now, we don't know what functions these genes, we have assigned them certain functions, but we do not know what or how they can be applied. So future researchers, we can address this database. They can isolate genes, clone them, express them, and look for different functions, and they can lead to many IPs or intellectual properties. Okay, so the challenge in the genome sequencing we faced was these corals are associated with dinoflagellates. So when we extract the DNA from these corals, they are actually associated, they are in, they cannot be separated out. The DNA comes together. We tried our best, but we cannot. So what we do is we have approaches with bioinformatics to separate the dinoflagellates and other contaminants from the genome itself. So, first I will introduce you to the sequencing technology. So, at the Biotechnology Research Institute, we have two sets of sequences. One is what we call the Pacific Biosciences, single molecule real-time sequencer, which can sequence large genomes or long stretches of genome. And the second one is the Illumina sequencer, which is a very accurate machine that can sequence small sections. So, what we do is the concept is something like this. The large sequencer, which is the Pacific Biosciences RS2, is basically used to build a scaffold. Okay. So you can imagine genome sequencing, you conceptualize it as something like you have a building, you construct a building. Before you put up the building, you actually have a scaffold. The workers need to have the scaffold. So once you have a scaffold, you have a rough structure of the building. And then you need to fill in with the bricks and mortar, so you use the Illumina for that. So by using this synthetic approach, we could construct a genome from a large organism. It would have taken five or 6 years maybe 10 years ago, but now we can do it in about 2 or 3 years. We can sequence the genome. So this is how we overcame the challenge of contamination. Now, because of big data and because a lot of sequences are available at the gene banks and public databases, our bioinformatics algorithms can filter out the extraneous DNA, which is the symbiont DNA, from the coral DNA. So we separated these out and we could get a picture of the genome. Okay, so this is how big data actually helps. Maybe 10 years ago, we can't do this. We extracted in DNA, we sequenced the genome. But because of public databases and sharing of information today, we can actually isolate our genome from the background. So even if your sample is contaminated with bacteria or fungi from the sea, you can still get your genome out of that. So once we do the sequencing, we actually assemble everything. And then we look for genes by a process known as annotation. And this gene database is now with the Sabah Biodiversity Center. It's available for, it won't be in the public release until they find specific IPs. And once your IPs have been found, you can release the remainder of the genome in the public domain. Okay, so the key genes what we found were the fluorescent protein and protein genes. So we have a database of these genes. Due to IP issues, I'm not at liberty to reveal the genes to you, but we found fluorescent protein encoding genes. Okay. This fluorescent protein encoding genes are being developed by Protein Technologies Limited to basically develop, this is an example of how they can be used for labeling cells. Okay. So suppose you have a neuron and you want to label certain sections of a neuron, you can develop antibodies and you can label the neuron with these fluorescent proteins. Provided that these fluorescent proteins do not have any immunogenic reaction in the organism. Okay. So this is where we look at, in collaboration with Protein Technologies, we are looking at deeply into this process. In fact, that's the first question they try to address. Are the FPs which we have discovered going to elicit an antibody response in mice? If they do, then we cannot go into people. So we have to look at other organisms for this, for downstream application. Okay, so some of the genes which we found, one of them is carbonic anhydrase. When we look at a database, carbonic anhydrase is an enzyme which is responsible for carbon fixation. So in today's world where everyone talks about global warming and carbon sequestration, this is a very important enzyme. It can be incorporated into organisms and engineered for applications. The other thing which we need to look at in the genome is something known as non-ribosomal peptides. As Prof. Charles mentioned earlier, that a lot of these organisms, corals, are producing bioactive compounds. So these bioactive compounds are synthesized by certain genetic pathways. Okay? And they are not synthesized in the conventional way using the ribosome and the protein. So when we look at the coral genome, we find the enzymes responsible for these biosynthetic pathways. So we can transfer these genes into bacteria or yeast and produce these compounds in them as well. So Protein Technologies Limited has incorporated these fluorescent proteins into antibodies. So they are in the process of filing for IPs and they are in the process of looking for commercial partners. Okay, so what I would recommend for in continuation of this project is that the state of Sabah set up a facility to explore the possibility of producing fluorescent proteins in Sabah. So you can look in terms of tagging these fluorescent proteins to antibodies, producing them in Sabah for commercial diagnostic applications. Okay. So, over the course of this project, we have been privileged to work with Protein Technologies Limited, Dr. Farid Khan, who has been a great advisor to us. He has, in fact, when we started off, we are all genome experts. We don't know much about protein. So, Dr. Farid is the one who actually introduced us to Protein Technologies. And then Dr. Fatah encouraged us to work with them and we came out with this end report. So a lot of our work is done by, I'm just delivering the presentation, but the work has been done by others. So I'm just compiling all the information. This is Mr. Rohendo, who has been very critical in this project. He's done the identification of the specimens as well as diving for them. And this is our research team. So Associate Prof. Dr. Vijay is with us. Dr. Chris is the bioinformatician who has done all the number crunching. And the rest are students. Mr. Dexter Lee is one of the students from Sabah who is very innovative. He developed his own algorithms and did the number crunching. So we didn't have to rely on others for this kind of work. I mean, we did it on our own. Okay. With that, I would like to thank our funding agencies and protein technologies, and thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. KENNETH, on the perceptive presentation of on fluorescent protein from Sabah's coral. Please remain on stage for the presentation of token of appreciation by Dr. Fatah. Dr. Fatah and Dr. KENNETH. Before we proceed with the last two papers,